Let's talk about family formals. No one really likes them. They're actually quite boring and they're not creative, but they're so important. And if you can't do them efficiently or effectively, it can actually hurt the rest of your client's experience throughout the wedding day. So I'm going to tell you today some tips and some tricks that we have put into practice the last 13 years in business that allow us to make family formals efficient, but also a great marketing tool on our wedding days. Hey there, I am Katelyn. Welcome to my YouTube channel. This is a place where we like to empower photographers to build both profitable and purposeful businesses while also letting you in the behind the scenes of our everyday life. If family formals are killing you as from the inside out, like you just hate them, maybe you just need more structure. Maybe you just need some tips to help you get a handle and control over that part of the wedding day. And that's what I'm going to do right now. So first step, it all starts pre-wedding. It starts before the wedding ever happens. The first thing you need to do is right now, if you do not have a client questionnaire, I have one linked below. You can download mine for free. You can start using it right now for free. Do it, because if you don't have a client questionnaire where you're asking people questions beforehand, you're missing out on so much pre-planning that can save you so much stress in the future. So in our questionnaire, we ask for family formals. We ask for a list from our clients. We do limit our clients. We say we will do 10 groupings. Now, are we strict about that? No. We're just trying to make them aware, like, hey, we're going to limit this a little bit because this could end up taking up all of your portrait time if we're not careful. So we need a list. We recommend having a limit. And we ask people to specifically give your family members the exact names on the list. Like, don't just say mother of the bride. If you are the mother of the bride, and this is the first wedding you've attended for like your one of your children, you're not used to hearing someone say, all right, I need a mother of the bride. You're not going to hear that and think that's me. You need to hear your name. So we ask for the actual names of the family members and then also their roles. This is huge. It makes a big, big difference when we can call out names and not just call out what people's titles are. Something else that we mentioned on the questionnaire is that we ask about unique family situations we should be made aware of. We almost every single wedding have someone list out like, hey, so-and-so, you know, they're divorced, but they're going to be together, or so-and-so doesn't do well with so-and-so. So maybe put them on opposite ends. Asking about family dynamics and what we should be aware of in terms of getting everyone together in a group picture really helps us feel like we're more in control of the process. Another thing that you can do, another tip, pre-wedding tip, is that you want to make sure you actually make time for family formals. There are a lot of photographers that think like, oh, we'll take a few family shots, but no, you need at least a half hour for this, unless you're literally just going to take a few portraits with the parents. But most of the time, even when people say, oh, I just want a few, people get added in and it can end up overtaking your portrait time. So buffer in 30 minutes of family formal time. And if you get done sooner, which we always get done sooner, then we just have extra portrait time to play around with. And it makes you look like the savior of the timeline because you knew like, hey, we're going to save this allotted amount of time. We might not need it all. And then all of a sudden they are on time for their reception. So allow time for family formals. If you don't, you could have it eat into the part of the day that you really don't want to lose. Last tip that you can do before the wedding is to tell your bride to tell their planner or just whoever's going to be in charge at rehearsal dinner, let your family members know that they are not to leave to go to the reception after the recessional. So when the ceremony is ending, people who are going to be in family formals need to know ahead of time that they can't get on a bus and go to the ballroom. They can't get on the bus and go to the golf club. They can't get on the bus and leave, or they can't walk to cocktail hour and start mingling with all these dozens and dozens of people. They need to just follow the family out and get right in line to start portraits. This is the number one way you can save time. So next step is you have to choose a great location. There's a lot that goes into making sure you're picking a location that's gonna work really well. I will be honest, the last two weddings I shot, there was one of them where I'm like, I actually don't know if I picked a great location. It's hard to think on your feet and direct this massive group of people that are excited and walking towards you. You gotta think about a lot of things. So what do you have to think about? Accessibility for grandparents. Are they going to be able to walk down the aisle and meet you back at a certain location? So don't go up a lot of steps if someone is having trouble walking. If you have someone that's a family member that is handicapped and has special needs, you want to think about, as a whole, can everybody get to the point where I'm trying to make family formals happen? Another thing to consider, which I ask our couples all the time, do you want to take portraits at the front of the ceremony spot? A lot of times people assume this, they want this, they paid for big floral arches. They want that captured and they envision their family formals being there. So if you're trying to move family formal somewhere else, you want to make sure that that's okay with your couple. Sometimes I tell people, hey, the lighting's not great up at the front of the ceremony, so instead of doing family formals there, why don't we save that a little bit later? I'll just do some portraits of the two of you in front of your florals, but we'll do family formals over here in the shade where it's a little bit cooler and where the light is even. Which leads me to my next point. Another tip, you want to make sure your location has good, even light. And it's not just even light on the bride and groom. It's even light across a big, large span of width, because you got to think about your largest group, right? The cousin shot, where grandparents are included, siblings and their spouses are included, kids are included, and cousins, that could be a 30, 40, 50 person group photo, and it's a lot. So you want to make sure you're not just looking at one spot, you're looking at the width. Like, could I fit a big group in this spot and still have even light on everybody? So another thing to consider when you're choosing a location is you wanna make sure the ground is level. You don't want one side of the family up here and another side of the family down here. That's gonna look odd. And it's also just gonna be an editing nightmare trying to straighten the horizon line when it wasn't straight to begin with. Overall, just remember this. This is not your opportunity to be super creative. That's coming once you get all this stuff done. You want it to be a well-exposed, well-lit, beautiful portrait, but you don't have to try to be uber artistic, right? You just need to get it done, and you need to make sure these key factors come into play so that you don't have really obvious issues like unlevel ground, uneven light, people are hidden. So take all those tips into consideration when you are trying to find your location for family formals. So here are some practical day of tips. The first tip is you want to establish gentle authority. I talk about this in the KJ posing course all the time. Photographers so often are viewed as like, you're just someone that stands off in the distance and like, you know, go kiss and kind of get together. No, you got to establish authority. You're in control. And a lot of times photographers are artistic people and they don't want to be in control. They just want to capture fun things as they happen. But when it comes to family formals and posing in general, you are the authority. You are the one in control. And if you're not in control, the loudest family member will be in control. The loudest bridesmaid or groomsman will be in control. So if you don't establish gentle authority, then someone else will take that place and you're going to feel like you have no say in what's going on. I would like to encourage you that people will respect and actually really appreciate you standing up and taking charge of this part of the day. I will give you a tip in a second about how to do that so you don't seem like you're a dictator, but instead you seem like she is in control. She knows what she's doing, but she's doing it in a joyful way. There is a way to be in control, but also be kind at the same time. So being under your command is an enjoyable experience and not something where it's like, gosh, she was a jerk. Like, you don't want to walk away from family formals, people being like, she just barked orders at me. No, there's a way to give people a great experience, but control the experience and make sure you're moving forward and not getting behind. Okay, another practical tip is ideally you would have help. And I don't know if I could do family formals without Michael's help. Honestly, we are so fast at family formals. We have been complimented on how fast we are. This is the number one time during the day when we actually win over all the family members because of our system. So without Michael, I'm just not sure we could be as efficient. We definitely could not be as efficient. So if you wonder, like, do I need a second shooter? Yes, for many reasons, yes. That's a whole nother video, but you need a second shooter, if not just for this one instance during the day. So what does Michael do? What is his role? First of all, Michael does not photograph family formals. He doesn't shoot them. He doesn't need to, okay? He has a different role. He is handling and managing the list, our questionnaire. He's finding someone else, kind of like a role checker. That's what we call them. That's what he calls them. A role checker, basically someone who is very aware that we need to stay on task, someone who knows everybody by name, someone knows who everyone is. Maybe it's a maid of honor, maybe it's an aunt. There's normally someone who's very clearly capable of this role, and he will hand them a list and say, hey, you go find, make sure everyone is here on both sides. Look through these names, make sure everyone is present. So then Michael isn't trying to wrangle people. Someone else is in charge of that. And Michael is focusing on getting started with who we do have there. And that's another tip. Don't wait until Uncle Joe gets off of the bus and says, no, you're not going to cocktail hour. Come on over. We're going to do this big group shot first. There are some people who say, start big and then go smaller. And I understand the reasoning behind that, but if not everyone is there, then you end up waiting for someone when really you could have gotten all the parent shots done waiting on one Uncle Joe to get to the location. So start with what you have. Something that's really important, we forget this quite often, but it's really important to have a pen or a highlighter or a pencil. I think Michael has used used lipstick before. We just have to have a really clear way to mark off what we've done. And sometimes Michael reorders it really quickly if it doesn't quite make sense to do it in the order that they listed out on the questionnaire. So you want to have a pin for your second shooter to be managing this. You also want to make sure your second shooter knows that they've got to be a little assertive. They've got to be involved. They've got to be shouting out, all right, so next we have the Braden family. All right, so we need everyone in the Braden family. You are on deck. So when I'm done, you know, so I'm photographing them and I'm saying like, all right, go ahead and get together. This is perfect. Mom and Dad, all right, you're leaning in and perfect. Braden family, come on in. And then right when Braden family is getting organized, Michael might help with that. And then he steps back. I start shooting and he's calling for the Jones family. The Jones family is on deck. So whenever we're done, people are being herded like cows, but in a very kind way. Like it's a kind herding, but they don't have time to have side conversations. They don't have time to just kind of talk amongst themselves. We're like in and we're out. And that part of the system, we have never been criticized for. We've only been praised for. People like this part of the day going quickly and they like the efficiency. Here's the truth. People who are in these group photos, they don't want to be here, right? They may appreciate having their photo taken, but most of the time it's like, oh, let's just get this part done. And like, we feel that, we know that. And so sometimes we'll even joke about that. Like the quicker you get in, the quicker you can get out. And it's great for us to kind of commiserate together with them. Like, hey, I know this is not fun. Let's get it done fast. And they appreciate that. So those kind of wrap up some of Michael's roles. He also is a purse grabber, a junk holder. People will get into photos and they will be holding stuff. Like every, you know, the aunt has collected everyone's program and has a stash of programs in her hand. And we will gently take that from her and say, we'll give this back in 2 seconds. Okay. So he will grab those things while he's calling the next group. He has a very vital role in this process. Some other practical tips. When it's possible, if we're not waiting for someone, the bride's family, I think, should go first. Why? Because they're the ones hosting people at this party and they can go host and get out of there faster. Now, it is a little tricky because you can start with the bride's parents, but you want to still get a parent shot with like the groom's parents, the bride's parents. You want to have both sides represented. And so that's something they need to wait for. So we don't necessarily say, all right, bride's parents, you've got a shot. Now you can leave because we don't want to have to come find them if we miss something. But it is kind of, I think, polite to have the bride's family go first out of respect because they've invested a lot in this day and they're the ones who are paying us. Another practical tip is when you're setting up a group shot to make sure you're looking out for curves or arcs or rainbows, whatever you want to call it. People do not naturally get in a straight line. It is actually hilarious if you think about it. If you watch people go and say, all right, just line up, it's always a curve. It's because when you're lining up, you don't really realize that you are out of line with the center, like with the bride and groom. They have to actually look at their feet to be able to tell that they're actually not in line with one another. And so we will explain to people, all right, act like there's a straight line here. So I need the curves to back up. We need a straight line right in the front. That's perfect. And then we move on and start shooting. Last but not least, your tone matters. All right. I do this to my children now. I say to Evie, which sounds nicer? All right, come over here. Or, all right, come on over here. Which one sounds nicer? Obviously, the second one sounds nicer. The first one sounds like I'm annoyed. It is so easy to sound annoyed during family formals and not even realize that you sound annoyed. If people pick up on the fact that you don't like this part of the day, or if they pick up on the fact that you're not really enjoying yourself and you're annoyed that you have to group all these people together, there is no faster way to kill your reputation and to kill your impact and to kill your marketing. If you want to be a fan favorite, like to anyone attending this wedding, to family members, the people that hired you to be there, you take control of family formals and you do it in a joyful way. I have seen so many photographers that I listen to them photographing family formals and I'm like, they sound mad. They sound mean. There's a way for you to be in control without sounding like you're a jerk. So pay attention to your tone inflection. That's the number one way that you can make sure that you don't sound like a jerk when you're trying to command authority and keep everyone on schedule. Instead of saying, all right, get together, you can say, all right, everybody, let's go ahead and get together. There's a huge difference there. And if you're in the midst of stress, sometimes you don't even realize that you sound like you're being really negative. So that's something to pay attention to. So why does this matter? Because this is actually one of the most powerful opportunities for you to make a name for yourself. It's not the part of the day where you're going to create your portfolio images, and it's not the part of the day where the bride and groom are going to be wowed and oohed and awed over the light you found and the portraits you set up for them, but it's the part of the day where the immediate family of your clients are around you the most. This is the part of the day where you can make comments to the mother of the bride and say, like, doesn't she look beautiful, talking about her daughter. This is when you can talk to the dad and say, like, it's just a joy to be here. I'm so thankful you allowed us to be here. This is beautiful. This is the part of the day where you can say to a family member, you guys are the best. This is just the best family. Okay, go ahead and get closer. Little things like that go a long way. At my wedding, 11 years ago, we paid $10,000 for photography. Mind-blowing. Back then, that was just ridiculous. And my dad, after family formals, came up to me and said, you know what, Katelyn? Well, Katelyn, he doesn't call me Katelyn, call me KK. He said, you know what, KK, Jasmine and JD, Jasmine Starr and her husband, they were so worth it. He said that after he had a personal interaction with them, after he had seen them work through family formals, after he had seen them in the morning when we were getting ready. Those moments add up, and that's when you win over people and you have forever marketing fans because they had a great experience with you. So family formals, you got to have a system and you have to be kind. And when those two things come together and you give people an amazing experience, all of a sudden you're kind of unstoppable, right? When you do that same day slideshow at the end of the wedding day and they already love who you are personality wise, they love that you were efficient. They love that you saved the timeline and you made up for lost time because you were so fast. They love that you were in control and you got everything done. Then when they see the same day slideshow images, they are just sold. There's no going back from that. You have won them over completely, but all of these little parts of the day add up to make your overall client experience, and your overall client experience is more valuable than any online gallery you can give them. All right, so I know that was a lot. It's a lot. But if you leave a wedding day and you're like, why was that so stressful? Why? What fell off the rails? It could have been any of the things that I mentioned. So slowly but surely, you can start being in control over these things and taking over being in control of what happens to you on your wedding days. Things don't have to happen to you. You can be in control of these things. So anyway, I hope you enjoyed this. If you'd like to watch me interact with my clients, interact with their families, win them over, do family formals, watch Michael do his thing, we show that in KJ All Access. We provide opportunities for photographers to see real life how we apply everything that I just taught you. And so if you want to try it out but don't want to pay for it, I get that. You want to make sure it's a good investment. You can actually have access to the entire vault, dozens of weddings, dozens of engagement sessions for free for 5 days. Link below, sign up for the KJL All Access trial, and I will see you in there. Also, make sure you like and subscribe so you don't miss other videos that are coming. I will see you next week. Thank you for tuning in. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.